always stop fighting when the potatoes are here.
Right?
Thank you.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I guess I could just turn more oftentimes to this side now. There's only two of you over here, so you know that. If I don't pay you much attention, don't fret about that, okay? We welcome you as we're gathered together. We have a lot of people who are away traveling, and you know, summer's so short, and it's good to have our opportunities to be able to rejoice. I know that even as we have the Haineses here, they also have a wedding coming up this next Saturday for their daughter, and we ask that God will bless that occasion and bless their lives through this union. And Lord, we also ask that we might welcome those who join us from a distance, for there are many who do so, and we appreciate them from Massachusetts to Oklahoma to wherever. I wanted to share some things as we, before we get to worship, as some of our joys. We received a letter from the McMahon Ryan Child Advocacy Center, and on behalf of the center, and the 1,500 plus children evaluated for abuse each year in Onondaga County, we thank you for your recent in-kind donation of 25 new blankets that go to help provide comfort and care for children under the threat of abuse in their lives. McMahon Ryan Center brings all essential services and supports for abused children to one safe, child-friendly location. Embracing the national model for the operation of a child advocacy center, the center enables law enforcement, prosecutors, child protective services, and the medical and mental health professions to work together as a collaborative team. The team's ultimate goal is to minimize trauma, break the cycle of abuse, and increase the prosecution rate of perpetrators. So we are grateful that we are participating in that. And so we have also contributed $325. So we're not a large church, but we do real well at being able to participate in mission in our community. We've also given several hundred dollars to our neighboring church up in Bridgeport because they're going to try something unusual for them. They, like us, don't have too many children. But they're holding a vacation Bible school beginning tomorrow, going all week, called Christmas in July. And so we want to be praying for them. There's cards if you want to pass them to someone, some family that you know that has children that might benefit from this. Please do so. Let's support our brothers and sisters just 5 miles north of us. And we are grateful for that opportunity and the fellowship that we share with them. Some bad news, or maybe good news, but for those of our guys, I know Joe and I participate, and Ron usually does if he's here. They're in Alaska, so you can be praying for them. They're celebrating their 6th anniversary, went to Alaska. The men's Monday morning men's Bible study is suspended until September 9th. However, our weekly Bible study at the town center, those folks say, no, we want to go all summer long. So we're meeting there at 10 o'clock in the morning, and tomorrow we should be finishing off the study of Galatians, unless they get me on a rabbit trail somewhere. We want to remind you that there is a concert of the Canastona Community Band. They'll be Saturday, July 13th at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and that will be on the lawn of the Chittenango United Methodist Church. We want to prepare you also looking ahead for the great opportunity we've had before. Last year, Darren was baptized, and he's here. But we have a church worship along the lake at Ron and Julie Kelch's home. And we have a big tent, so we're having a tent meeting. And we'll have a wonderful time and a wonderful barbecue all for free over on the lake. So please remember to join us. It will not be at our regular service time. It'll be at 11:30 a.m. as I checked my calendar from last year. So you'll find that the address is in the back of your bulletin. Hi, Marion. I've tried to stall as long as I could.
I'm here.
I know. She told me not to stop picking on her.
No. Okay.
All right, good. All right, so we'd like to have you, if you can, participate, bring some other people. We'll sing, we'll have great worship, and we'll also have a great meal together. If you're bold enough, Ron will take you out in the boat on a tube and try to throw you off, or you can take a nice ride in the boat and not have to worry about being thrown off. So those are kind of the joys that I want to bring before you this day as we gather to worship. So as we do that, let us now change our focus from us and what's going on around us to put our heart and mind so that we can be sensitive to the presence of God. We don't invoke God's presence here. God is already here. It's rather we invoke our presence to be with God. Let us do so.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I got ready today to come here to do this, and I said, well, I gotta be red, white, and blue, right? And I couldn't find anything white, and my son came up and he said, Dad, let's face it. You've got plenty of white.
So it was dependent upon your kids.
So our call to worship today, we gather to be reminded of our task as God's own people.
To preach good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberation to the enslaved, and the opening of prisons to the bound.
To proclaim that this is the time of the Lord's favor, and it is also the day of the vengeance of our God.
This is the day to comfort all who mourn, and give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning.
We gather as the people of God, and also as the people of a democracy, celebrating 248 years of existence.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all persons are created equal, that they are endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
The prophets of justice and the patriots of liberty call us to this hour. We worship the Creator of life, the true giver of all liberty, and the Son who redeems us from the consequences for the abuse of that freedom, and who shows us the way to sustain liberty, to know what is true so we might possess abundance in life.
We worship in the Spirit of God's Son, for those whom the Son sets free are truly those who are free indeed. I invite you, so you can cool your back, to rise from where you are seated, if you are able, and lift your voice with mine as we sing America the Beautiful. Oh, beautiful, far spacious skies, forever ways of grain, for purpose. Beyond the years, thine.
driven by human tears. America, America, God mend thine every flaw, and perfect soul in self-control, thy liberty in law.
The love of God is more splendid than purple mountain majesties. God's word of grace fills the spacious skies. The amber waves of grain remind us of God's abundant care. Above the fruited plain is God's eternal joy in anyone who turns from sin and follows the path of truth. In every nation, in every heart, God is working for good. Let our songs rise, and let God's praise be heard from sea to shining sea.
Join me in prayer. O God, you who rule over all nations and people, and to whom all are accountable, we are grateful to live in a land where we possess the freedom to worship you. We gladly exercise that freedom to gather here in the sacred space to worship. We know that freedom is not free, and our present freedom has been borne by the sacrifice of many. Our faith reminds us there is no true freedom without justice, and justice is not found where human sin abounds. We struggle with the use of our freedom under your grace. Your word clearly states that you cause nations to rise and to fall depending upon their faithfulness to those principles which you have made known. Save us from deep grief and misfortune caused by our moral failure. Bless us with your wisdom so that the poor may not be oppressed and the rich may not be oppressors. May we cherish the God-given right to life, liberty, and our pursuit. You have the pursuit you have desired for every person. Make this nation to have no ruler except you, O God, a nation having no authority but that of love. May our worship reflect these values. Amen.
Amen. You're welcome to take your seat, but please raise your voice as we continue our singing of My Country, 'Tis of Thee.
My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims bright, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. My native country, the land of the noble free, thy name I love. I love thy rocks and rills, thy woods and templed hills. My heart with rapture thrills like that above. From all the trees, sweet freedom song. Let mortal tongues awake, let all that grieve partake, let rocks their silence break, the sound prolong. Our Father's God to thee, Father of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom. freedom's holy light. Protect us by thy might, great God, our King.
Thanks, God. Please.
Thank you.
Be seated.
In Congress, July 4, 1776, the unanimous declaration of the 13 states of America. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitled them, a decent respect of the opinions of mankind required that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence indeed will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes. And accordingly, all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while the evils are sufferable, that to right themselves by abolishing the forms which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same object, evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security.
I invite you to stand if you would. And you'll find that there's an old flag that hangs behind you. I'd ask you might take a moment and turn and face that flag, and then let's recite together the Pledge of Allegiance. Then, if we turn this way, we'll recite also the pledge to the Christian flag and also the pledge to the Word of God. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again, with life and liberty to all who believe. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. It's been always my pleasure when my children have graduated from Little Lambs. We have our last child that graduated from there. And when they do their closing program, every day, they say those three pledges. And then this past couple weeks ago, I listened to my little granddaughter, along with her classmates, recite Bible scriptures they've memorized from A to Z. It's remarkable. But it's wonderful that we can have that freedom. But the hymn that we're going to sing now reminds us, as it was written during the Civil War, that there is a path of justice. To be able to honor God means that we have to honor the truth and that we have to be willing to sacrifice for the truth. So I enjoin you to sing with me the battle hymn of the Republic.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. I have seen him in the watchfire of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching. God. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never call retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea. He the glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free, while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching. God.
Praise God, please be seated. As she finds where we are, I'd like to lift up some things from that hymn as sermon number one. Number one is that it says in verse 3, he is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. He is sifting out our hearts right now. Not just in the coming when we will be judged, but we are being judged in how we live even right now. How we choose what we live. There's also another sentiment. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free. We die to ourselves when we serve our country that stands for freedom, but we also die when we serve our Savior. We die when all of a sudden we accept the responsibility to proclaim Jesus, to share Jesus with others, because no one is truly free until they know Jesus and live Jesus and walk in Jesus. So the question is, we're being sifted, our hearts are being sifted. Do we have enough love that we invite, that we share what we know of the love of God through Jesus Christ? I pray we do, for time is marching on. Then the last verse, which we didn't sing, is, he is coming like the glory of the morning on the wave. He is wisdom to the mighty, he is honor to the brave. So the world shall be his footstool and the soul of wrong his slave. Our God is marching on. Even when we don't think that God cares or God is interceding, God has a plan, and his plan will always be fulfilled, and God is marching on. The question now is, are we marching on with God and his plan? I just have you reflect on those things, because we can sing these hymns, but we can neglect their true meaning, and the passion behind a faith behind those who compose them. As we gather today, I want to remind you to celebrate some of the joys we have. We have the birthday of Julie Kelsch that's coming up on the 11th. So you might want to send her a card. They should be back.
They are home.
They are home. Okay, they're catching up on their sleep. See, they can text Kathy up there on the computer. We also have the birthday of Savannah Perry, and that is on the 12th, so please remember little Savannah's birthday. Steve Case, who has a birthday also on the 11th, and Steve was here a couple weeks ago and shared with us the great concern for his daughter, Katrina, that she broke her back and is paralyzed, and she has three young children, so please be keeping Steve in your prayers and his family, if you would. We want to remember Ron and Julie Kelsch's anniversary, which is on the 30th. That's why they went to Alaska. So if they're watching, we want to sing happy anniversary to them. Also, Cindy and Eddie Betts, they have their anniversary. And Ruth and George Kirk had their anniversary on the 5th. I called and interrupted them and sang happy anniversary to them. But let's sing happy anniversary to those people who are having anniversaries. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you. And a happy birthday. A happy birthday to you. A happy birthday to you. May you feel Jesus near every day of the year. Happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you, and the best that you've ever had. Turning to some of our prayers, I want to add, they're right there before you, including Katrina. We want to remember Sharon Nichols, and I said that she's critical there, but I visited her at Iroquois Rehab Center, and she's doing well. She was arm wrestling with other residents. After having a lot of difficulties with her health. And she's also, her son's making sure he's bringing down a hymnal so he can play, because she's an organist and pianist. And they've accredited that with her great recovery, actually. So that's an interesting thing. We also have those other names that are there that we ask that you might be lifting them up in prayer. I would just add these two new ones for you. One is for Dick Ford. Dick Ford used to play the piano organ for us, and Dick has had a stroke, and Sharon's not with us because his daughter is not prepared to help take care of him, and so he is being taken care of by Sharon this right now. So I know that Sharon's a great caretaker. She loves caring for people, and so we want to be praying for Sharon and also for Dick. We also want to be praying for Kathy Morgan, who has a young woman who has a severe infection from a spider bite. So that's really limiting and threatening her life. So we wish to pray for her. You may, yes. Marian, you were praying for her name is what? Joanne, who's had heart surgery and implant of a filter to catch clots and whatever. So we want to add Joanne into our prayers. I want to lift up Pam here. I know Pam has been struggling with her health on and off for several months. And she's getting rather impatient, as it doesn't seem to see much improvement. And it takes a lot of work for her to be with us this morning. And we're glad that you are with us. And we will pray for you. I'd ask that if there are concerns that you have that you'd like us to be praying for, there's prayer cards both in our lounge and also in the pews. Please feel free to fill one out so that we can be praying for you. Another one we add is Russ, who is here, and he's struggling with cancer in his lung, and still doesn't know quite what the treatment protocols will be, but we want to be praying for Russ as well. Let us be in silent prayer before the God who hears all, knows all, and has a plan for all. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for who you are. Thank you for your compassion. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for the grace by which we live each day. Let your grace be known in every circumstance. And so we unload the burdens of our heart to the one who is fully trustworthy. I'd ask the congregation, would you stand that we might say the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Oh, I had you stand because please turn and greet one another with the peace and love of Jesus Christ. Love one another. Let us love one another in God's love. In God's love. Let us love one another. Let us love one another in God's love. In God's love. Let us serve one another. Let us serve one another in God's love. God's love. Let us serve one another. Let us serve one another in God's love. In God's love. As you take your seats, let us then listen to the word for today. doesn't come from the New Testament, comes from the Old Testament, from 2 Samuel chapter 5, verses 1 through 10.
Today's word: all the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron, and he said, "We are," and they said, "We are your own flesh and blood. In the past, while Saul was king over us, you are the one who led Israel on their military campaigns. And the Lord said to you, you will shepherd my people Israel, and you will become their ruler." When all the elders of Israel had come to David, to King David at Hebron, the king made a compact with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned 40 years. In Hebron, he reigned over Judah 7 years and 6 months, and in Jerusalem, he reigned over all Israel and Judah 33 years. The king and his men marched to Jerusalem to attack the Jebusites who lived there. The Jebusites said to David, "You will not get in here. Even the blind and the lame can ward you off." They thought, "David cannot get in here." Nevertheless, David captured the fortress of Zion, the city of David. On that day, David said, "Anyone who conquers the Jebusites will have to use the water shaft to reach those lame and blind who are David's enemies. That is why they say the blind and the lame will not enter the palace." David then took up residence in the fortress and called it the City of David. He built up the area around it from the supporting terraces inward, and he became more and more powerful because the Lord God Almighty was with him. Some questions to ponder of life and faith. What qualifications did David possess to warrant the trust of the elders? Which promises of God are you still patiently waiting to see fulfilled? If you had the absolute assurance that the Lord is with you, how would that affect your life? What fears would dissipate? What challenges would you take on?
I've been leading us on a short series that is the exclusive claims of the gospel. The first week, we looked at what Jesus said in John chapter 14, after giving comfort to his disciples, preparing them that he was going to be leaving them. He said, "Do not be anxious, do not be afraid. Believe in me, believe in God, trust in God." And he said, "In my Father's house, there are many rooms. I tell you this because I'm going to prepare a place for you. Matter of fact, I'm going to come back and take you so you may be where I am. And you know where I'm going." Of course, Thomas always asks those good questions. "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how do we know the way?" And Jesus gave this exclusive claim: "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes unto the Father but by me." A lot of people don't like that claim. We talked about that. There's other claims that Jesus made, and another one was also expressed in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 7, where he says, "Enter into through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate that leads to destruction." Narrow is the gate that leads to life. He also said in the Gospel of John, in chapter 10, he says, I am the gate. So enter in through the narrow gate. It means we enter in through Jesus. In John 10, he also says, if you enter in any other way or try to enter any other way, you are nothing but a thief and a robber. You have in mind other things, and the only thing you want out of faith in me is what you can get. Not because you truly love me and you realize that I'm your shepherd. Well, that's a little bit my interpretation of that. Excuse me. So now we come to the Old Testament. You know, we have those exclusive claims, but you know, those are claims that we have, and we can say, okay, we believe or we don't believe. But our acceptance of the narrow way, how do we find the narrow way, is found every day. Not through just big things, but also the everyday small decisions. I came upon this passage this week in my reading, the story on David. And I found that this gave us a little bit of a hint of how we find our way. You see, it is our way. Because our way is God's way. And if our way is God's way, then we need to discern our way. We need to discern then God's way for us. We need to be able to find our way every single day of our lives. So this is what spoke to me about that. And we see that all the tribes of Israel went to David at Hebron and told him, we are your own flesh and blood. In the past, Saul was our king, but you are the one who really led the forces of Israel. The truth, it was he and Jonathan, Saul's son. And the Lord told you, you will be the shepherd of my people Israel. You will be Israel's leader. And so they made a compact. They made a covenant in which all of a sudden all the elders of all the tribes said, okay, you're the man. You are going to be our king. And David agreed to it. We don't know what he expected of him. It's not declared there, but they made a covenant. We don't know precisely what the negotiations were there. What's so strange is that, you see, David was already king. Earlier, all of a sudden, when Saul blew it as the leader of God's people, God told Samuel to go to the house of Jesse. He looked through all seven brothers, and he picked the last one, the youngest one, the one who would not expect to be a leader because he wasn't very impressive. You can read the description of David, and it makes him a little bit more, how do I put it, effeminate, can we say? He was in his complexion and his stature, which was so different from that of Saul, because when all of a sudden Samuel chose and anointed Saul, he was an impressive figure. You know, there are certain people in which you would then respect in their leadership, their stature, how they stand. You know, there are some people you might go along and you say, well, I don't want to meet that person in a dark alley. You know, that's someone that you're automatically going to say, you know, if I'm going to follow someone, I'm going to follow that person, right? If you're going into battle, you're going into some conflict, you want to be standing next to the person that is impressive. You know, I want to stand behind Joe, you know, a Marine, likes to lift weights, you know. I'm going to make sure that I'm going to be with someone that commands respect. That's what Saul was. David was so different because you wouldn't expect him. But what qualified him in order to understand the way of God for him? It's so interesting in the story of David. You know a lot of the story. I know you must. If you're raised in Sunday school at all, you know the story of David. All of a sudden, Saul was at war with the Philistines, and oh my gosh, you know, they were kind of playing a chessboard, you know. All of a sudden, they have a little skirmish over here, There'd be a little skirmish over here, but they never did really engage for months in battle. They were too fearful, except that they would have their battle lines, and they were getting nowhere. And there is this one gigantic, impressive dude that commanded respect, who stood up, you know, his name is Goliath, and he would challenge them. Come on, send your best. Let's duke it out. If I win, you're our slaves. They win. That's not likely. We'll be yours. All of a sudden, David comes along. He didn't go to the battlefront because he wasn't impressive as a soldier. He turned out to be a great soldier. He didn't have the stature. He was younger. He was sent there with food from dad in order to make sure his brothers were taken care of. And then he engaged the battle. He said, what are you doing? The Lord of Heaven's armies, and you are allowing them to mock you? Now listen to that word, that phrase that I just said. David had in concern the reputation of God. That's what qualified him. He was concerned with what God wanted. He was concerned for God's people. That's one thing that qualified him. After winning the battle, you know the story, all of a sudden he goes and he's enlisted in as a servant to the king, King Saul. And in being his servant, all of a sudden, he started going out and he started winning battles. Jonathan, Saul's son, went out and did battles. Meanwhile, you know, Saul was back home having a good time. And David would go out. He was noted for the battles, the strategy, and the capability that he had. Who do you look for in discerning your way? Those who are able to face the battle and win the day. Who do you want to stand with? Who do you want to stand near? The one who's been proven and wins the day. Sometimes we are not good at choosing our leaders. I know we're in that season. I guess that's why this passage came up before me. We are not always so secure about where our nation is going and who it is that we have to choose to be our leaders. But David gives us a little insight of what we need to look for. May not be that we'll find it, but we can look for it. Someone who had the heart of God and had a heart for the people of God or his people. But there are other things. We find that Samuel anointed David while Saul was still king. Saul had goofed up. There are two particular instances of which Saul had goofed up. Okay? Number one is that all of a sudden he was going out to battle the Philistines. And Samuel had given him instruction, you've got to wait until I get there and we'll worship first. Then you can go out to battle. You worship first, then you go out to battle. If you're going out to battle in your life, this is the way that God has laid out for you. We worship first. We cannot be prepared for the battle unless we worship first. But all of a sudden, Samuel was late. No, we can pray, we can worship, and we can lay our hearts before God and say, come on, God, where are you? Where are you? And God seems late. But you know, God always shows up. The question is whether we're going to be patient or impatient. And sometimes in our impatience, we like to put ourselves ahead of God. Instead of waiting for God at the right time that God allows us to, you know, tells us now is the time. We say, well, I'll just go do it. What God wants, so I'm just going to go do it. That's unfaithfulness. And all of a sudden when Samuel showed up and all of a sudden he saw that Saul, as king, overstepped the bounds of his responsibilities. There were separate responsibilities. And he overstepped them. And he started offering the sacrifice. At that point in time, God told Samuel, he's not the man. He does not have the heart for me. and immediately he left. And God directed Samuel to the right person, the right time, and he anointed him. But yet Saul was still king. Oh, the second thing that Saul did was all of a sudden he went to fight the Amalekites. And in doing so, he was told by God that anything that you capture, the spoils of war, were to be turned over to God. There's reasons for that. Because war is not a place for greed. We go to war on principle, not out of greed. But all of a sudden, the soldiers, they wanted the spoils of war. And Saul was so insecure that he decided that I'm going to allow them to take certain spoils of war. And when Samuel caught him breaking the word of the Lord, he had all sorts of excuses for his disobedience. How about us? Do we have excuses for our disobedience when we're trying to discern our way with God? God says, do it my way. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. Do it my way. I don't understand. But I can do it this way. No, this way. And we get impatient. And so all of a sudden, we have these other people say, well, they're not following me. They're going to abandon me. They're not going to support me. I'm going to be doing this alone. God says, do it my way. Do it my way. I don't care how many follow you. I don't care how many pat you on the back. I don't care how many agree with you. You discern my way and you go my way. That's hard to do. He had all sorts of excuses. Well, the men, they wanted that. And we just captured the king of Agag, and we just were bringing him back to Gilgal and the spoils of war, and then we were going to then give them over to God. God didn't. He said, that's not the way I told you. In discerning our way, hopefully you're discerning what I'm saying, is that there is a commitment to God, commitments to people. There is a commitment to doing it God's way, not our way, and not presuming to overstep our boundaries. Let God be God. Follow his way. Even when it's uncomfortable, even when it's uncertain, even though there's fears that confront us, we fear our undoing if we do it God's way. Oh, they're not going to like us. The popularity. Well, you can be popular all you want. I've known a lot of popular people who wound up dying miserable deaths. I could name them, but you know them. Popularity doesn't cut it. Obedience, faithfulness does. Now let's turn to the heart of David. He was willing to be a servant of Saul, even though Saul, he knew the kingdom was going to be taken from him. He played the lyre for him. He calmed him in his mental state of instability. He suffered when all of a sudden he realized that Saul realized that it was David who was going to take his place. And he chucked spears at him. And then he sent him out to fight his battles. And then he all of a sudden sought so many times to destroy David because of the threat that he presented. But each opportunity, David was faithful. All of a sudden, as he was fleeing from Saul, he hid in a cave with some of his men from Judah and Benjamin, those two tribes. And all of a sudden, Saul was hunting for him, and all of a sudden, he had to go bathroom. I love this story. He had to relieve himself. So he went into the cave where David and his men were hiding. And he had his opportunity. He snuck up on the king. He could have killed him right then and there and taken the throne, but he said no to his men who had urged him to do so. This is the man that was anointed by God. God can take him out, but I will not harm the Lord's anointed. A second time, when they were chasing David, and Saw the camp of Saul, and they were in a deep sleep. David and one of his men went down And they didn't wake up. And he could have killed Saul. And he told his men, no, I'm not. Then he took something from the part of the cloak from Saul, went up on the mountain. The next morning he yelled out, hey! You didn't do a very good job by protecting your king. Look what I got. I could have done it, but I didn't. And I won't. I will not kill the Lord's anointed. It is God's responsibility to deal with Saul, not me. Oh, there's so many things about David. All of a sudden, he just was going along with his men and said, boy, I'm thirsty. I'd like to have some water from that. He didn't realize he wasn't going to send some men, but all of a sudden, a group of men decided, we're going to endanger ourselves and go get our leader that gourd of beautiful fresh water. And what did David do? I can't drink this. I can't use myself and my needs and sacrifice other people for them. A good leader in finding our way, we sacrifice ourselves, but we do not sacrifice others. Let me say that again. We sacrifice ourselves as Jesus sacrificed himself, but we do not sacrifice others. There's so much. God did take care of Saul in God's good time. And then this story that we come up here in chapter 5, all of a sudden, hey, all the elders, not just of Judah and not just of Benjamin, the tribes that he came from, but all of them came. You won the battles in the past. Not Saul. You were the one that was anointed in the past. Samuel. You are the one. Be our king. You know, we have to look and see, who is it in the past that has won our battles? Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit. God has. We need to look and be able to understand whom God has anointed, and that is our Lord, and that we then are committed to the way, the Lord's way, not our way. The problem in our nation, in our world, is everyone thinks they have their way. We know the way. And when we follow our way, there's a way that seems right unto a man that leads to destruction. But there is a way that if we follow the way, every single day, in all the large and minute decisions, we find our way. But you know, how much time did it take that David has, a young man, when he was only 14 and fought Goliath, to when he really ascended to the throne when he was 30? He patiently waited for the victory. So we too must faithfully wait for the victory. But we need to be steadfast and true to the way that has been revealed to us. So much more in that story. Sometimes you're interested in why they chose Jerusalem. I can tell you that too. But that's another time. So instead, let us have a time of prayer. Oh Lord, we come before you. Our nation is in turmoil. Our world is in turmoil. Oh, we are frustrated. Oh, Lord, we are frustrated. And so we only claim Isaiah 64. You come to help those who gladly do right, who remember your ways, but when we continued to sin against them, you were angry. How then can we be saved? All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind our sins sweep us away. No one calls on your name or strives to lay hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and made us waste away because of our sins. Yet, O Lord, You are our Father. We are the clay. You are the potter. We are the work of your hands. Do not be angry beyond measure, O Lord. Do not remember our sins forever. Oh, look upon us, we pray, for we are all your people. Those words from Isaiah, may they remind us of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ that is offered to us. Let us acknowledge that we have sought our way, not always the way of God. And let us receive his grace. We lift up the bread, recalling how the Lord met with his disciples. He lifted up the bread and he broke it. He said, take this, eat this, all of you. This is my body. It is broken for you. If you but take it and eat it, this will be the bread of life for you. Our Lord then took the cup, blessed it, said, this is not just wine to make you feel good. This is my blood poured out for you. So also pour yourself out for freedom. For those who are in me will be free indeed. Will you pour yourself out that others may be free? Lord, show us the way of life. Help us to be committed to it. Help us to follow it. For we are weak, but you are merciful and powerful. We give you praise. In the name of Jesus, amen. We invite you to come forward. Take of the bread and take of the wine. Take it together. And know of God's love for us. Also pray for our nation. For nothing will change until there's a revival of God's spirit of love and passion in our midst. His life for your life, his love for your love. His life that he gave that you might have life, that you might have it more abundant and free. Blood. his life he gave that you might have life, that you might have it more abundant and free. Greater love is there, not in this. He gave his life for you. His blood poured out for you. His life that he gave that you might have life, and you might have it more abundant and free. His life for your life. His love. Life that he gave that you might have life, that you might have it more abundant and free. His life he gave that you might have life, that you might have it more abundant and free. His life for your life, his love. His life for your life, his love. I took more time today because I'm very fearful for where we are. And I really pray that as the people of God, we might pray for our nation. You might pray for revival. We might truly be earnest about representing Jesus Christ to our neighbors. I pray you'll do so. I've held you long enough so we can play that hymn. We'll just do one verse. First verse. Come, live in the light. Shine with the joy and the love of the Lord. We are called to be light for the kingdom, to live in the freedom of the children of God. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. Please come downstairs and enjoy a time of refreshment, as we have refreshments downstairs, and continued conversation. And may the Lord be with you. May the Lord challenge you during these days. But may the Lord be the one that goes ahead of you and brings you peace, because you know who is the ruler of all. Amen.